Welcome to Raw Discourse, the most controversial podcast in the world.
We got a special guest in the building today. I mean, not just special. I mean, I say that for everybody, but, you know, Joel, living, you know, future legend in the building, you know what I'm saying? Youngest state representative of Michigan history, you know, Joel Jones. I appreciate you coming on, man.
Hey, brother, I'm just happy to be here, bro. I'm just happy to be here down here in Dallas. I wish it was a little warmer. You know, we just had our first little layer of snow in Michigan. I was expecting to come here to get a nice little 67 degrees.
I know, man. It's 22 degrees today. You picked the worst day of the year to come out here. But yeah, so we're going to jump straight into it, man. So when I told everybody I was interviewing you, right? How old are you, Joel?
24 and a half.
Yeah. And you a state representative. You've been doing this for how long?
3 years now.
Everybody asked me, they was like, how in the hell did he do that? They was like, what's the secret, man? They feel like you had somebody in a position that put you in there. He had to have some kind of family connection. So how did it all start for you, Joel?
I think basically for me, it's just been a relationship with a man, you know. I've been working for people for a long time, working with people for a long time, volunteering. My parents had me all over the place. All the rest of my folks had me everywhere. So just being present in the community when opportunity, you know, presented itself, everybody just wanted me to go ahead and take advantage of it. So I'm task oriented.
So how did you grow up? Like, what's the family structure like for you?
You know, I had both my parents. I had a big family. You know, I had my family. I had my spiritual family at the church. I had the family I knew from the neighborhood. You know, I had a very large family. I learned a lot from all different kinds of people growing up. So, you know, I had a very well-rounded experience coming up when I was growing up. So,
right. Very well-rounded experience coming up. Okay, so you grew up with both your parents, right?
Yeah.
So then you was very involved in the church.
Yeah.
And then, so where'd you go to school at?
I went to school in the neighborhood at first, and then we ended up going outside. I went to the burbs to go to school when I got to high school. Better schooling and stuff, better sports teams or whatever. And I went that way. And then when I went to college, I was basically kind of in the neighborhood, probably about 10 minutes away or so. University of Michigan, Dearborn, doing a few things.
So you grew up primarily in Inkster, Michigan?
Primarily Inkster, yeah.
Okay, so would you say was Inkster like considered like, is it different parts? Like, is it like a good or bad part?
I mean, I think the whole city is beautiful. I think a lot of people talk about, I grew up in the city too, like Detroit. But I think the town is beautiful. You know, I think Inkster is beautiful. It's different size, of course. You know, you got the north side, you got across the Ave, you got Saigon Gardens. People break the city down to all these different neighborhoods or whatnot. But you know, I look at the whole city holistically, I think it's beautiful no matter where you go. Right. It's just about being smart, just like with being anywhere. You know, you treat people with respect, people treat you with respect.
Absolutely.
You know, you take care of yourself, you know, pay attention, don't be doing nothing crazy, you'll be all right.
Okay. So how do you go from 18 years old, you're at Michigan Dearborn University, right? How did you get to, from there, state representative in Michigan's history? How do you do that?
A year after I was 18, 19, I ran for city council in my hometown.
What made you do that?
People told me to do it. I thought it would be dope.
Who told you to do
council,
it?
The folk in Inkster. City council seat opened up. So people was like, you know, you should run for office. And I was like,
you just
be
did
cool.
It? At 18, you just thought it was possible that it was going to work?
At 19, yeah.
At 19.
You know, like, I didn't feel like, you know, I grew up out there. I didn't feel like it would be bad. People were telling me to do it, and it was the voters. So I was like, you know, it'd be cool. Went ahead and did it. And a year later, that's when my state rep passed away.
It was Julie
Pawecki, passed away. We got a nomination from the party. We just went ahead and rocked with it, ran a campaign, beat the Republican.
Now, I read that you did that because you put a Facebook post up.
Well, yeah, the city council,
yeah.
I did city council. Yeah, you know, people tell me to do it. So I asked, you know, I felt like, okay, this would be cool to do, but I made a Facebook post. And I was like, man, if I get a lot of likes and stuff on here, I'm going to do it. First time, I got like 300 likes, you know, like 200 comments.
That was the
like,
first time you ever got that many likes and comments.
Yeah, this was 2015, January 12th, 2015. That's when I made the Facebook post.
And then you just went and ran and did it.
That was it.
Just like that.
Just like that.
You still glad you did that?
Oh yeah, you know, I definitely want to do something else in life, but you know, I fall in love with politics.
Right.
Now it's a lot. It's a lot I can do to give back, and I got a good team, good support system. So we moving the right way.
Okay. And then so you become state representative. I mean, what was that adjustment like being like 19 city council meeting? Like, what was your day to day task? Like, was you doing just that because you were still going to school too as well? Right. And then like, did you have a regular job as well too?
No, I didn't have no regular job. I mean, I was doing like consulting work, kind of like on my own schedule, doing whatever I wanted to do. I joined the Army my freshman year. So, I mean,
why did you join the Army?
Some stuff. Because I wanted to do some other stuff, you know, work related. So I joined the Army, used that as kind of like the avenue to get to where I wanted to be.
Mm-hmm.
But then when I ran for office, kind of like I put all that stuff on the back burner and just started serving in a different capacity than what I had planned on doing.
Okay. So yeah. You joined the regular Army, you joined the Army Reserves?
I joined the Army. So I was in the Army and I contracted with the Army. I was going through ROTC because I wanted to be an officer. Because, you know, I was like, you know, it'd be cool to be an officer and a black officer, you know, be in a leadership position in the Army. Didn't just want to serve. So I was going through that, through the process as well. But eventually, 2 years in 2016, I switched over to the National Guard.
You switched over to the National Guard?
Yes, I've been with the National Guard since 2016 now, so for a few years now.
Okay. And then, so you like being National Guard more, you like being in the Army?
I mean, it's the same thing. It's just like the reserve component of the Army. So it is the Army Reserve.
Right.
Army Reserve is federal. National Guard is on the state level. So,
right.
I mean, it's still in. You still get to do some of the same stuff. It's just slow motion. It's basically set up for like civilians who still want to serve.
Okay.
So I moved to that position because as a state rep, you know, I can't be like full-time Army.
Right.
And also, you know, be in the legislature. So it worked out. It's cool. You know, it's a lot of good people there that I work with in the civilian side and on the military side that I, you know, are my folks, so I still like it.
And you're a cop too, right?
Yeah, I'm an auxiliary police. So, you know, I get out there every now and again.
So,
get on my toes.
So you're a state representative, in the National Guard, and you're a cop.
Yeah, and an uncle too.
And an uncle too,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, my uncle now. That's my slow motion job.
And you're 24 and a half.
24 and a half.
How, like, what makes you want to do all these different things at the same time? How do you even make time to do all these different things? Because most people... Yeah, I know dudes that got problems, man, just trying to work just at Walmart part time. They can't do it. They like, man, I ain't got no time in the day to do this. So you an uncle, you know, you state representative, you National Guard. Like, how do you make time in your schedule to fit all that in?
I mean, it's plenty of time to do whatever you want to do in life, you know. I make time. And I think staying busy keep me out of trouble. So, you know, we all got the same 24 hours. It's just like how much, I don't sleep a lot. Mm-hmm. I be up all the time. I'm always on the move, always on the road. So kind of just depend on like what you want to do in life. If you really want to do that kind of stuff, you know, you just make a decision to. And so I think that's, you know, that's what I'd be doing. You know, I just stay up, keep on doing it. I try to exhaust all opportunities, try to max out all the time I can, you know, get some rest when I need to. But besides that, it's like it's time to work right now. You know, you put that investment on the front end and you chill on the backside.
Right.
Yeah.
And so also you also made Forbes as well too, right?
Right. Yeah.
So how'd you get in contact with them? Did you reach out to them or they reach out to you?
They reached out to me. I had the chance to attend a summit in Boston last year.
Okay.
So I was just, you know, doing the same thing I do all the time, building relationships, networking, whatnot. Some cats that was on the list nominated me, I guess. So this year I got the nomination. So I made it on the list, the Forbes list this year. But, you know, it was just relationship building when I got there, just doing the same thing I do everywhere. Just be networking, talking to people, saying hello, sitting down, chatting with folk. I think building some of those relationships plus the nominations that had came in, it's kind of just like we was a good fit for him. So I've been working closely with him now. I'm just trying to really bring them to the neighborhoods and expose a lot of my other folk to Forbes, you know.
Right. And then do you feel like in your position that you're in now, with you being so young, do people take you serious in politics?
Yeah, I think so. I think at first, and probably when I was on like city council, stuff like that, a lot of people was like, oh, man, he's too young. He's too this, he's too that. But now, like, after they have the chance to work with me, they seen our whole rap sheet. I don't want to say rap sheet, but our track record. I think people definitely are like, okay, you know what? This is somebody I can support. This is somebody I can work with. He's doing good things. You know, the team is doing good things. So I don't think people have that.
Worry that anymore about you.
Right, right.
So, and I just saw that you had a House bill passed through Congress, right?
Well, not well, through the state legislature.
Through the state legislature, yeah. Right? And that has to go to the Senate.
Right.
To get passed again, for it to become a full law.
Right.
So, and that's for people to have marijuana expungements off their record, right? Mm-hmm. So it'd be easier for them to get jobs and stuff like that, right?
Exactly.
Why do you feel so passionate about that to try to push that bill through? Was that bill wrote by you?
Well, no, I didn't particularly write the bill. We worked on drafting the bill with the Attorney General back in Michigan and another Representative Isaac Robinson. And then we had the endorsement from the governor as well. And I mean, it was a part of a package that we rolled out around expungements in general, because like expungements, you got felonies on your record, misdemeanors, you know, stuff like that. It stops you from ownership, stops you from employment, right. You know, access a lot of times. So it's just like, you know, it's time to get people right back to life. And so especially when you see recreational marijuana becoming a thing across the nation and people about to make all the profits and stuff over it. And it almost makes sense to just say, you know, these people that's been locked up for nonviolent marijuana offenses, why not go ahead and free them, you know, get them a chance back. And then let's go ahead and throw a social equity component on it as well to say people that's in the neighborhoods who look like me, let's go ahead and give them some resources so they can go ahead and, you know, get involved in this business too.
Right. And they can make money.
Right.
Like they were trying to do originally,
right,
but it was illegal.
Exactly.
Right. So do you feel like marijuana should be legal everywhere?
I mean, you know, I think life's all about choice, you know, so it's like whatever is present, whatever is available, whatever people have access to, people are going to choose to do what they want to do, regardless if it's legal or if it's illegal.
Right.
I just got to hope that people make the right decisions, you know, and they don't abuse different things. And so
right.
I don't think it's up to me to say that marijuana should be legal everywhere. But if it is legal, you know, anywhere, I think it definitely we need to go ahead and start paying attention to how we are handling the situation. Because, I mean, when you see like the just unfair treatment of folk in different states or in different areas or for people from different backgrounds, it just don't make sense, you know.
So. Right. And do you feel like with this being said here about the expungement and all that with the records,
mm-hmm.
do you feel like moving forward that, like you said, they should be giving some social equity back to everybody that was already being convicted of that? They should
right.
have a foothold in that
exactly.
business starting off, right?
Yeah, it makes sense.
And also as well, with you being so close to the, you know, Flint water crisis, what was your take on that?
I mean, that was just people putting dollars before the people, you know. It's like everyone knew, we seen a long time ago, the water was, you know, putting rust on auto parts I think it was a Chrysler plant. And when we seen that years ago, you know, should have made sense. Like, we shouldn't have people drinking this kind of stuff. And so I think when people made the switch over off of the Detroit water for whatever reasons, it's like, you know, people wanted to save money at the expense of people's health, you know. And so I think it definitely was a lot of bad and wrongdoing that went into that. But it really just makes a second guess. Like, who are we electing? Who are we putting in office? Who are we giving power to appoint other people? Because these are people that's going to be making decisions over our day-to-day lives, you know, believe it or not. And decisions they make are going to affect you.
Right.
So, you know, it's a lot of stuff. A lot of people we need to hold accountable even now. But it just really make us take a second look at, like, you know, government.
Right. And so what would you say is like the top three issues that you probably care most about
right now? I think just generally speaking, I'm always concerned about the infrastructure, always concerned about public safety and then economic and community development. You know, and that can include a myriad of different issues. You know, I don't really look at things too particular. I just had like these overarching views, like this is what we need to improve. There's a lot of different ways to go about doing stuff. It's a lot of different opportunities to get involved in stuff. And, you know, it's a time and season for everything. So I don't like being too specific because you never know what opportunity might come up that
right.
might be accelerated versus, you know, something that might take a longer process to complete.
Right. So when you bring up like the infrastructure of, mm-hmm. let's say, Detroit, right? And I know a lot of people say that city is a dying city.
Mm-hmm.
Why do you feel like that is?
Well, I don't feel like it's a dying city. I think definitely downtown right now is booming. You got cats like Dan Gilbert and, you know, even with a coordinated approach like from the mayor and a few other families in the Detroit area who are doing great things downtown, not really too much in the neighborhoods. But, you know, of course, when people are building empires and building cities, it starts off somewhere and then they expand it. I think the key right now, I wouldn't say it's a dying city, it's just people just have, you know, lacking access and opportunity in terms of the gentrification. You know, it's like gentrification is going to happen everywhere. Now, as long as, you know, we have access to the gentrification, as long as we have access to that development that's going to be coming, it's fine. But the moment that people who live in the neighborhoods or in the community are forced out and not able to get, you know, take part of like these deals and stuff that's going on, that's when it becomes a problem. I think if someone is to argue that's a dying city, that might be wise because the people who have traditionally been there are no longer seeing or reaping any benefits from
right.
like the new development.
So would you say gentrification is a good thing?
I mean, gentrification is going to happen regardless. I'm not sure if it's a good thing. A lot of things are going to happen. Gentrification is good if everyone is able to. Gentrification is good if it's equitable. If it's not equitable, you know, it's not a good thing. Per se, because of course, I mean, at the end of the day, it's capitalism, right? Capitalism is an adversarial system, requires winners and losers. And so I think it's important to note that everybody's not going to make it. But I mean, as long as somebody, you know, who has the people's best interests at heart is in that mix, I think we're okay. But the moment that people are getting in and they're just greedy and they're just doing it just for themselves, I think that's when we start running into issues like we're seeing right now in Detroit.
Right. And just another thing, what do you think about, like healthcare around that issue? Like, what do you think? Do you think we should have like free healthcare for everybody? Like, I know it's a running topic right now and the election is going on. What do you think about that?
I mean, you can look at some, you know, people always talk about Canada and stuff like that, you know, about how they have free healthcare. I think if we figure out a way to fund it and whatnot, I think it makes sense. You know, a lot of people are, but at the same time, it really depends. It's just like starting a business. Before you start a business, you know, you might have great ideas and think it's going to do great things, but if you don't have a market for your business, right, you know, you're not going to go nowhere. So I think it's important also to know that, who is really going to take advantage of the healthcare when you get it. Because I think people have a lot of opportunities sometimes, but just from a cultural standpoint, from a traditional standpoint, a lot of times people don't take advantage of things that they have or resources that they have. And that's an educational problem that we have sometimes because we don't know it's available to us. But I mean, if it would help out folk, I think it would make sense. And we should explore those options.
Well, I mean, I think the only problem I have with free healthcare, like in Canada, it's a lot less people in Canada than the United States. Then also as well, people in Canada normally have different type of lifestyles than we have right here. When I say that, I mean like they have different eating habits, they have different working out habits. And I feel like a lot of people, especially in our community, are not as active as they should be, or they don't take care of themselves like they should be, you know? And I feel like if I'm a person that's doing everything I can to take care of myself, make sure I'm not going to the doctor, why should I be taking care of someone I know that smokes cigarettes and like they smart, you know? Because you know people that smoke cigarettes and they smart people. They know cigarettes give you cancer and they still do it. You know, and so that's the only thing about free healthcare I can't really wrap my mind around. I would feel like as long as we had stricter standards, especially even with kids, because if you notice now, a lot of kids are overweight. You know, that's a big topic going on right now in America. If we took better care of ourselves, I could probably understand free healthcare. But as of right now, I just can't see how it's feasible.
Right.
Because people, I think at that point, they would lose the incentive to try to take care of themselves, you know?
Well, I don't know. I mean, it all depends. You know, I think because you have to look like what's the opportunity cost or what's the opportunity gain from giving people free healthcare? Does this mean we're gonna have more productive citizens? And people are gonna be working, going to work more. It's not gonna be as many sick days off. Are people gonna be healthier to be able to start other different things? Or is people gonna lose interest and just say, you know, what if I get sick or something? I can just go to the hospital and utilize this free healthcare. I'm not exactly sure what it looks like, but I think if it's an option that people are interested in going, that maybe that's something we should explore, take a look into, and maybe there's a way we can put some standards or some kind of requirements on it to just help people point out, hey, if you plan on utilizing this, these are a few conditions that you have to meet in order to accept it, you know.
Well, I mean, I think they did the same thing with Obamacare. The only thing, a problem with Obamacare was that the fines just weren't as high as they should have been for people not having it. And that's why people didn't get it. It's because it's like, oh, well, instead of me paying that bill, I'll just pay the fine when it comes in, you know. So it's always going to be something, you know, that makes it unaffordable for somebody to do it or make it unincentivized to do it. So just the fact of finding that perfect stance is difficult, you know?
Yeah, but I mean, that's what the decision makers are here for, you know, is that's what we, you know, the influencers, the decision makers, the policy makers, you know, the business leaders, all that kind of stuff. That's what we're here for. We got to make those kind of decisions. Sometimes hard decisions, but you know, at the end of the day, it's not always about, you know, what our own pocket is going to look like or what our own, you know, return on investment is going to look like. Sometimes just, you know, having the best interest of people, what's going to be the best thing for the community for.
Right. Because
we need to be looking at the future generations that's coming, not always looking at ourselves presently.
So. Right. And this is the last time I'm going to ask you, Joel. What is, and don't nobody get mad at me, Joel only had 20 minutes today, y'all. That's all he has. So don't be mad at me about this interview, sure. I know everybody was looking forward to this. I was talking to. Last thing I'm going to say, Joel, is that what are your goals moving forward as far as your political career? Do you plan to stay in politics? Do you plan to go get a regular job eventually in the corporate area, in the corporate sector? Like, what are your goals moving forward?
I don't think I really have goals too much. You know, I've got like targets, I guess, but those like pop up, you know, when they pop up. So, you know, for the foreseeable future, I see myself, you know, continuing my service. I'm not exactly sure what the capacity looks like. You know, I got 2 more years left in the House after I run my campaign next year. So, and that's what I'm focused on right now. It's just about what am I doing right now. I'm not really necessarily always looking at it. I think opportunities to present themselves. When they do, I share them, you know, with everybody and whatnot. But for right now, I'm just focused on what's at hand and trying to, you know, put that investment forth so I can figure out how do I impact the future in the most positive way.
And also as well, what do you think about the 2020 election coming up? What do you think is going to happen with that?
Oh, it's going to be interesting.
It's going to be interesting?
Yeah, I'm not a psychic, but it's going to be interesting. I know that much.
Okay. You got any ideas about who the front runner may be for the Democratic Party?
I don't know just yet. We about to find out, though.
We about to find out?
Yeah, it's coming soon. Coming soon.
Do you think it's a chance that Trump might get reelected?
Oh, without a doubt.
Without a doubt?
Without a doubt, it's a chance.
You think it's a high probability he might get reelected?
Probably so.
Probably so? Oh, wow. So you thinking that?
Probably so.
Why would you
say
that?
All politics is local, though, so I'm not even concerned really about national politics that much. You know, people might say that's a bad thing, but all politics is local. You know, you need to be looking at your legislators, your senators, your congresspeople. You need to be looking at, you know, after them, looking at, you know, your mayor, your council, your county commissioners, your county executives, those kind of things, your judges, that kind of stuff. That's what's important.
Because those people that you have interactions with day to day. Right. I understand that completely.
Yeah.
Well, okay. Well, appreciate you for coming on, Joel.
No problem, friend.
It was great, man. It was great.
Thanks for having me on, man.
Oh, yeah. No problem, man. Anytime. Okay. We got to grind this back up. We got more time, man.
Without a doubt.
Okay, man. Well, this Raw Discourse, Joel, the legend. Thank you for coming on, man.
Yes, sir.